Hello guys, I hope you all are doing good. I am Vishali Kikan and we are discussing the VLSI technology. In that, we are discussing the chemical mechanical polishing or the CMP, and today in this video, we are going to talk in detail about the CMP slurries. I hope you all have watched all of the previous videos on the CMP, and in the previous video where I was discussing about the CMP hardware, I told you the slurry dispenser is a very important component of the CMP hardware. But there, I didn't talk about the slurry. What is slurry as of now, we don't know. So today, let's talk about the CMP slurry system, right? What is slurry? Why it is required? Why it is a very important part? Let's discuss about each one of these things. So what is CMP slurry? CMP slurry contains some chemicals. These chemicals are going to react on the wafer surface, and with the help of the reaction, they are going to form some compound which is going to remove by the abrasive particles. So now what is happening? So in the slurry, we have some chemical. These chemicals are going to the wafer. Here, when it reaches the wafer, it is going to react with the wafer, form a compound. This compound is removed. So what is happening? This wafer is going to become mechanically abraded. It is going to etch out, or it is going to remove the layer of this wafer. So what is happening? We are having the abrasion of the wafer surface, or I can say particulates in the slurry mechanically abrade the wafer surface and remove the materials. We have some additives also present in the CMP slurries which help to achieve the desired polishing results that we want. So now coming to the various other properties, how the CMP is working. So the working of the CMP can be understood with the help of the toothpaste. Okay, we all are doing the toothpaste in the morning. So what the toothpaste is going to do? The toothpaste is going to kill the germs, right? It is going to remove the tartar on the teeth, the yellow kind of thing that we have, the tartar on the teeth, it is going to remove, and at the last it is going to form the protection layer on the teeth. So in the similar manner, the slurry or the CMP slurry is going to kill the germs, remove the tartar and form the protection layer on the wafer. So let's discuss it how. So particles abrade away unwanted coating from the tooth surface during the tooth brushing, right? This is what is happening during the tooth brushing. Particle abrades away the unwanted coating that is present on our teeth. While we are eating, we are having some unwanted coating present on our teeth. We have to remove it, and this is the reason we are doing the tooth brushing. Okay, so in the similar manner, we are doing the chemical mechanical polishing to remove the unwanted layer on the wafer surface. So water-based chemicals with abrasive particles and the chemical additives are used as the slurries. Okay, we have the water in the slurry, we have the abrasive particles, and we have the chemical additives. So different polishing process require different slurries. So slurries can impact various things in the CMP, like the removal rate, the selectivity, the planarity, the uniformity. So slurry is, this is the reason slurry is very important part of the CMP hardware. Slurries always are engineered and formulated for a specific application, right? If I have a particular application, I will be having a particular slurry for this case. And if I have a different application, I will be making a different slurry with different additives, with different water-based chemicals, with different abrasive particles, right? So now coming to the types of slurry. We have oxide slurry, then we have metallic slurry. The oxide slurry is alkaline solution with the silica. Alkaline is having the pH at 10 to 12, right? And the metal slurry is acidic with the solution with alumina, right? And here we have the pH from 2 to 6, right? So now I hope you understood. We have the neutral pH at the 7 pH, and if I go below it, from 7, if I move towards the 0, I am going to get the acidic structure or acidic character, and if I am moving from 7 to 14, I am going to get the basic character. So you can see the oxide slurry is basic character and the metallic slurry is acidic character, right? So now coming to the delivery of the structure. So slurry components are stored separately. Right, how we are storing the slurry components? We have the particulate. The particulates are stored with the deionized water, right? So deionized water with the particulates are stored. Additives are stored for the pH control, and the oxidants are there for the metal oxidation, right? So we are having a flow to a mixer to mix at the required ratio. As I told you, for the different applications, we have the different slurries, and how we are making the different slurry with the various components. If I change the ratio of each one of these components, I am going to get a different slurry. I am going to get a different application for this particular slurry. So you can see we have the deionized water plus suspensions, pH adjuster and the oxidant. So with the help of liquid flow controller, we are going to give the different ratio of each three of them. And here we have the mixer which is going to mix all of them, and then this is going to CMP tool. So this is how our slurry flow would be looking like. So now coming to the oxide slurry. Okay, so I have already told you the basics of the oxide slurry based on the experience of the optical industry. In the optical industry, oxide slurry is used where? For the mirrors. Okay, so it is used in the optical industry for polishing silicate glass to make lenses as well as mirror for a long time. Right, oxide slurry is a colloidal suspension of fine fumed silica particles in water. Silica is SiO2 particles. Its colloidal suspension in water is oxide slurry. So here I can use KOH to adjust the pH from 10 to 12, and also we can use ammonium hydroxide. So NH4OH can also be used. So the abrasives used here are fumed silica particles, and it contains 10% solids, right? And the shelf lifetime of it is up to 1 year with proper temperature control. So this is a very big shelf lifetime, and we can use it. So fumed silica particles are formed in a vapor phase hydrolysis of SiCl4 in hydrogen oxygen flame. So this is how we are forming the fumed silica particles. The silica particles contains SiO2. So first of all, we are going to react H2 and O2 to form H2O. Now the SiCl4, right? So SiCl4 is going to react with the H2O. So this is the hydrogen oxygen flame that we have, right? So now hydrolysis of SiCl4 is done with this flame. So now its hydrolysis is going to give me SiO2 plus 4 HCl. It is going to evaporate, and this is how I am going to get the fumed silica. So overall reaction will be SiCl4 plus H2 plus O2 is giving me SiO2 plus 4 HCl. So now this is how the fumed silica particle formation would be looking like. What I am giving? I am giving the SiCl4, H2 and O2. So at the temperature which is greater than 1800 degrees Celsius, we are having the higher temperature here. This is going to form the reaction of O2 and H2, and this is the aggregates that we are forming, and the temperature is decreasing when we are cooling, and at the lesser than 1710 degrees Celsius, we are going to get the agglomerates or fumed silica particles, and this is the collection system from where I can collect the fumed silica particles or SiO2. So this is how our fumed silica particles would be looking like. So you can see this is a very beautiful picture, depicts the fumed silica particles. So now coming to the metal polishing slurry. So first was the oxide slurry, then we have the metal polishing slurry. The metal CMP process is similar to the metal wet etch process. I have already talked about the wet etching of the metal. Here the oxidants react with the metal to form the metal oxide. Like if I have aluminium, oxidants are going to react with the aluminium to form the aluminium oxide. Then the metal oxide is removed, and we are going to repeat the metal oxidation and the oxide removal till the time we are wanting our structure to be removed. So the metal CMP slurries usually are pH adjusted suspension of alumina. So alumina is Al2O3. So we are going to adjust its pH as well. The slurry pH controls the two competing metal removal mechanism. First is metal corrosive wet etching, and second is metal oxidation passivation. So these two metal removal mechanisms are actually dependent upon the pH of the slurry, metal corrosive wet etching and the metal oxidation passivation. So if I have different metal oxide, they have the different solubility. If oxide is soluble, then wet etching will dominate. Okay, it is not favored because it is isotropic with no topographic selectivity. We want topographic selectivity. We want the higher removal from the rough surface more. Okay, so it is not favored. If oxide is insoluble, it blocks the further oxidation. So particles mechanically abrade the oxide layer. Repeating metal oxidation and the oxide abrasion will be done. It is favorable because here we have the high surface topographic selectivity, right? We are going to remove the rough surface only. So if oxide is insoluble, we are going to get a better planar or better uniform structure. Okay, if I have the soluble oxide, we are not going to get a better planar surface. So the pH value controls the oxidation process, and this is the reason we have to control the pH values. Okay, so we can use the Porbeck's diagram. When pH is lesser than 2, tungsten is in passivation regime. Tungsten can form the passivation oxide, the tungsten oxide with pH lower than 4 in the presence of an oxidant. We can use various oxidants like potassium ferricyanide or ferric nitrate or hydrogen peroxide. For a higher pH, the soluble W12O41-10- WO42- and W12O39-6-, these are the various ions that can be formed and it can cause the wet etching. So you can see the Porbeck's diagram for the tungsten. It is the pH versus the potential volt diagram for the tungsten. You can see this is the stable structure which is represented with this purple color, and this color is representing the corrosive structure. So WO3, WO2 and W are the stable structures that we have, and these are the various ions which are corrosive in nature. So now coming to the tungsten slurry. So first of all, we have to adjust the pH to allow the low wet etching rate and the chemical mechanical polish removal. So tungsten slurry normally are quite acidic with pH level from 4 to 2, right? So pH level is very less and the tungsten slurry are very acidic. Tungsten slurries have lower solid content and much shorter shelf lifetime. So this is the reason we have to use it as soon as possible. Tungsten slurry require mechanical agitation prior to and during the delivery to the CMP process. So now coming to the aluminium slurry. Aluminium slurry is having the water-based acidic solution. I am using the hydrogen peroxide as the oxidant over here. I am using alumina as the abrasive over here, and the shelf lifetime again is limited. Hydrogen peroxide molecule is unstable, right? And this is the region the oxidant is unstable and the aluminium CMP is not properly used. It is hard to compete with the copper metallization. Now coming to the copper slurry. Copper slurry is the acidic solutions that we have. Okay, all of the metallic slurry are acidic. So oxidants here are hydrogen peroxide, ethanol, HOC2O5, and nitric acid, HNO4. We can use the ammonium hydroxide with potassium ferry and the ferrocyanide, or nitric acid with benzotriazole. So aluminia is used here as abrasives. So you can see the Porbeck's diagram for the copper. Okay, here we have this as the stable structure. This is the potential volt versus the pH diagram. So you can see here we have the passivation regime with the stable alumina. All of these structures are unstable. So you can see this is the corrosive CuO2-2- structure that we have. Here we have Cu, Cu positive, Cu2 positive. Both of them are corrosive. And these two are passivation structures, CuO and Cu2O. So now the copper slurries need colloidally stable slurry to achieve consistent polishing process results. Right, a colloidal stable aluminium suspension can be achieved when the pH is just below 7. And I told you the metallic slurry will be having the pH lesser than 7, but here we just need the pH just below the 7. Only a small window for the copper slurries will be required to achieve both electrochemical passivation and the colloidal stable suspension of aqueous aluminia particles. So I hope you understood a lot of things that we have discussed in this video. So if you want to understand about the slurries in detail, you can refer these three books. These are amazing books that you can refer for your detailed analysis of this topic. I hope you understood each of the things that I have discussed. If you have any doubt, you can put the doubt in the comment and I am going to reach out to you as soon as possible. I hope you like this session. If you like it, please push the like button, subscribe to the channel, and also do share it with your friends. Thank you so much.